So I think I got the camera sorted out. Let's hurry up because this battery might not last long. I'm not sure. It's fully charged, but anyways, just a second here. So this is my PX4 Storm Compact, 9mm. It is not my carry gun, my everyday carry, concealed carry gun. I want to explain exactly why I was supposed to kind of gradually change from one gun to the other after spending a lot of time. I've shot quite a bit of ammo out of the gun so far. I've had it probably about a month. Waiting for my screen to turn on here, and it has my handy dandy range log. Okay, I don't know. Okay, so it's not totally washing out my screen. So I have 304 rounds out of the gun so far as of today, and I've owned it maybe 2 weeks. So that's a pretty good damn start. So I'm ready. I fired self-defense ammo from it. I've also fired other ammo from it. I didn't notice it choking on any of the ammo. But one of the reasons, and I want to talk about this, one of the reasons, the main reason why I switched over so quick is because the Grand Power started acting all hokey again. This time with Winchester white box, 124 grain. And you know, as you can see, this is full metal jacket. And to be honest, this is actually an out of spec ammo casing. So if you look here, I'm not sure if the camera is going to pick it up. As I roll this, you see a flat spot, and I'm looking at the preview on my phone now using the GoPro app, and it's actually showing on the camera. Another way to do this is to let me pick up the camera here. You hear it, and you can kind of see it kind of rolling, but unevenly. So that got stuck in the gun. The gun did not like that. It wasn't just something that I'd fired 20 rounds and then it started doing it. It did it on the very first round. You see this magazine here? It was the very first one. It did not want to go in. It didn't want to go fully to battery, and I was like, what the hell? And I kept hitting the slide forward. It didn't want to go forward, so I popped it out and looked at it, and I was like, oh, it's scarred. It didn't want to go in the chamber. So that was pretty much the last straw for me. I was pissed off, because it seems like this gun always has issues. And granted, that was an issue with the ammo being out of spec, and wouldn't you know, I knew it was out of spec because this, when I switched over to the Storm, this is the same ammo, a different box, but the same ammo. It's got the same lot number listed in the inside of the packaging. So it came from the same grouping, but it was a different box. Here's the box. They look the same, but they're two totally different boxes, right? This is the first round. This was at the top. It did the same thing with this gun. That's how I know that this ammo is out of spec. In fact, if you look at this ammo, you'll see a twist in it. I'm trying to get close without it blurring. That's from it being rammed into the chamber. Yeah, it scarred it up really good. And this one got stuck as well, and I had to clear the gun. And I can feel the ammo doesn't feel quite right. And if I roll it, it's the same way. Now granted, some of that rolling is because of the scarring, but I have a feeling that it would be doing the same thing if I had done that before I placed it in the gun, right? So we know that the ammo is bad, or at least those two rounds. But here's the thing, the Storm, it choked on the first round, it ate all the rest without complaint. With the Grand Power, it didn't do that. It must have, I had to clear it and bang on the slide probably 6 to 7 times out of that 50 round box. So yeah, it did not like it at all. And so I get tired of trying to figure out this gun. The other white box I shoot, you know, I've shot in the past, never gave me an issue. This one does. Then we have the Storm eating it without complaint. So yeah, that was the last straw for me. It will be a range gun. And you know, to be honest, let me play devil's advocate here. If all I shot were SD ammo out of it, there probably wouldn't be an issue, because SD ammo is always very much scrutinized, because a person's life depends on that ammo. Practice ammo, not so much. So maybe I am kind of being a little bit harsh on the Grand Power. I don't know. I mean, I've given it its fair share, but if you look through my range log, it's got a, I mean, I've shot it the most, you know, and it was me trying to kind of get the gun to wear in, because it was having issues with the Remington, and it took me a long time to figure out that it didn't like the Remington. And now I'm finding out in this case it doesn't like Winchester white box. Yeah, that's a little bit too finicky for me. So yeah, it gets retired, it gets put to the side. I am now carrying this. The gun is clear, by the way, and it's dirty as hell because I took it to the range today as well. I've been on a tear with this gun. Let's go back to the range log here. 1, 2, 3. It's been to the range 4 times this month, including today. The first, so it hasn't choked on anything. It also loves 147 grain, which is why I bought 147 grain self-defense ammo. So it loves this as well. In fact, I was very accurate with it. Let me get my okay. Sorry here. This is with the HTP. This is the first one. This is from 7 yards. It's always between 7 to 10 yards for me, with the majority of it being 7 yards. And here's the second one. That's with the Remington HTP. It's actually pretty damn good. This grouping's a little bit better. It's tighter, and I actually was hitting center mass. This is Winchester 124 grain. Trying to think of that's pretty much a whole box. So between all of those, it's 50 or 49. So the groupings are actually outstanding, because if you look at this, that's one group. I'm trying to remember if it was one or two magazines, but that's actually pretty good groupings. It's vertical. I was kind of rapid firing. So there's less spread this way, but there's spread this way, and that's me trying to deal with the recoil. So if I'm going to hit anywhere, it's still going to be center mass in the center, vertically, but there's not going to be a lot of spread horizontally. So here, these are all DA shots. What I was doing was I had the gun in my hand, but it was low. And what I would do is I would put the gun in DA mode, and then I would try to pretend that someone was approaching me. And with a gun in DA mode, your first shot is going to be DA. So what I was practicing was to try to squeeze off that first DA shot as quickly and as accurately as possible. Actually I did pretty damn good. That grouping is actually pretty tight. And if you notice, yes, I missed the head here, but I was only shooting for the head because I had already filled out this part. So I wanted to kind of be able to see where I was hitting at, and I saw those. So I need to keep practicing this little exercise here. That's going to help me a lot. That's going to help me learn the DA trigger. And most of these are SA triggers. So I'm trying to force myself to learn both triggers. Here is just sort of like this down here where I was being lazy and did not want to use a sticky target. I was running out of range time, so what I did was I just pretended a sticky target was there and I just started popping off rounds. So again, this is rapid fire. You can see there's a vertical spread, but not so much a horizontal spread. And even if I didn't circle these, you'd see a definitive pattern here. 1, 2, 3. So the groupings are actually relatively tight. So that gun has kudos. You're gonna give kudos to the user friendliness of the gun. I love it. I have no complaints about it whatsoever, with the exception of the very wide controls. It's a little bit heavy, but it's something that I'm gonna get used to. So what's coming down the pipeline? I ordered a slew of stuff for this gun. Tonight I did. So I went to the range today. I didn't intend to shoot anything. I thought I was just gonna meet my future boss to discuss some work-related things. So we went over there, and his idea was he wanted to shoot. And luckily, I had my gear in the car, in the trunk. So I went back out and got my gear. We went in and we spent pretty close to an hour shooting before we talked business. I got a chance to shoot his gun. He was shooting an XDM. That's a Springfield full-size service weapon. That thing was nice. I was actually shocked at how nice it was. I was able to shoot it. I didn't have to worry about, I have an XD Mod 2 subcompact, and I swear, everyone hates the grip safety. I mean, not the grip safety. Well, they hate that too. They hate the grip zone. That's actually what sells that gun, in my opinion. It's extremely comfortable. And you would think that a gun that short, I think it has a 3-inch barrel, would have a serious amount of recoil that you have to deal with. That gun shoots very soft. It shoots extremely soft for what it is. And that's all due to what people hate, the grip zone. So it's not telling you where to grip the gun. It's a trademarked name that they gave the patterns of the grip areas, the front strap, the back strap, and the left and right parts of the front strap, the left and right parts of the back strap, and the sides of the grip. Each one has a definitive texture, and it does help a lot in dealing with the recoil. But his did not have that. It had like a little grid square deal along the grip. It felt good. It felt good. I have striker fired guns. I actually have a good bit of them. I have a Glock 22. I have a Glock 19. I have two Canic TP9 SAs. I have a P320C, and my wife has an SR9C. So I'm familiar with striker fired guns. I spend most of my time with the DASA guns because I carry. And so I want to be as familiar as possible with the DASA triggers. Between guns, there is a difference between trigger pulls, the trigger pull characteristics. But shooting another DASA gun, even though it's not the same as, for instance, this, it still helps me to kind of learn trigger pull for a DASA. So with all that being said, I shot his gun very well. I was actually surprised. So that might get put on my list of guns to get. Not this year, maybe next year. But it was very nice. I was actually surprised. So I shot his gun well. He shot my gun. He actually did pretty well considering that he, if it was the other way around and I was I'm shooting striker fired and he's shooting DASA and we swapped guns, I would probably have more of a problem adjusting than he did. So he actually did pretty well. He liked the heft of the gun. He didn't say if he liked the trigger. He shot his gun better, of course. He's used to that gun. But he did like it. One thing that I was going to mention here is I asked him, I said, I have my own ammo. I can go and get it. He was like, oh, don't worry. And of course I'm carrying this gun. So I only have two magazines right now. So I had to empty that of its SD ammo. And what I was doing was I was using both of the magazines during the range session today. So he said, no, I have my own ammo. What he bought 1,000 rounds of Tula ammo, and he bought a small ammo can, and he was using that. He was like, just use mine. And so that was a cool test because I fired how much? Today I fired 75 rounds of his Tula ammo. Not a damn hiccup whatsoever. It ate it all. And the gun is still dirty and it should fire fine, so I'm not gonna clean it. I was impressed enough, and he said he spent like $134 on 1,000 rounds of it. So I was like, oh shit, I'm not using a Grand Power anymore. And the Grand Power, actually, I shot Tula out of it before, a box of it. I think two boxes, and it ate it fine. So that's not something that the Grand Power doesn't like. It didn't have a problem with it. And we're finding out today on my boss's dime that it likes Tula. So what I did was when I got home, I ordered 1,000 rounds of Wolf. I was hoping to get heavier grainage because that's what the gun likes, that's what I like. But I couldn't find any. I think the only place that I saw that had 124 grain Wolf was sold out. So maybe next time. But his was 115 grain and it shot fine. So that's what I did, and I bought it at Ammo Depot. And I bought two of their 500 round cases. They were selling a 500 round case for like $75, so I bought two of them. So I can't wait for that to show up. What else did I buy? I went to N82 Tactical, and right now I'm carrying this in an Alien Gear holster. I have several Alien Gear holsters. I have a couple. I think I have three Cloak Tuck 3 3.0 holsters, and so I got a shell for this. I need something that is easier to pull off and put back on, because I don't, you know, I carry out of my house, but as soon as I get to the car, I put the gun in a travel case under the seat, because I work on federal property, and the last thing I want to do is go through that gate and I have a gun strapped to my hip. So I'm a firm proponent of the right to bear arms, but not to the point of where I'm gonna be challenging someone on federal property, you know, by carrying, by being strapped. That, no, I'm not gonna do that. So the idea is for me to, when I get into the car, the first thing I do before I even turn on the car is unholster my weapon, put it in the lock box, put it under the seat, and remove my holster, and I got a place in the car that I always put it. And all of that's hidden out of sight, because I don't want, you know, we have security guys walking the premises all the time. Last thing, and there are law enforcement people on site. That building has more law enforcement people than not. The last thing I want is a Leo to actually be walking by my car and see gun paraphernalia in the car. So, but anyways, so I ordered a Nate square holster. That's what it's called. I say N82 sometimes, but it's Nate square because there's two owners. They share the business, and both of them are named Nate. So it's Nate square, you know, Nate and Nate. So anyways, I bought one of those. I bought their professional a series of holster. So that should be help me to kind of quickly go from not carrying to carrying. With the Alien Gear, with the way it is, I have to sometimes unbuckle my belt and drop my pants a little bit in order to get the holster into my waistband. It's not so bad taking it out, but with the Grand Power, I was using a Kydex holster, and that was super easy to slide in and out. A good idea would probably have been to get another Kydex, but I did not feel like chasing another place. It took me a while to find that for the Grand Power, and while this gun is popular, it doesn't have a lot of aftermarket support. More than the Grand Power, but less than, say, Glock. So that holster should be coming in soon. So I have the ammo and the holster coming in. I also ordered three more mags. So part of the problem with having only two mags is if I'm carrying all the time, I have one mag that's always full of self-defense ammo, and it's usually inside of the gun. And with the Grand Power, I started out with carrying two magazines. Well, one that was in the gun, and one that's in my glove box in my car. So when it was time to go to the range, I would always keep the one that's in the glove box in the car, right? So I would have to rely on the one that was in the gun, and every time I needed to, you know, get some range time with it, I would have to empty what was in the magazine, you know, at the range, you know, burning range time, and swap out the SD ammo with practice ammo, and then before I leave, do the reverse of that, so that I'm prepared to defend myself as soon as I walk out of the door. So that's a hassle. So it took me a while to find those magazines, because if you go to the Beretta's website, they are $40 a piece. That's kind of expensive. Not as expensive as the Grand Powers. The P11s was $50 a piece. That's why I ended up getting the P1s instead, because they were cheaper, and I can use them. They just kind of extend out. So I ended up buying 3 Beretta magazines, and I was getting ready to pull the trigger. I found some for like $33 at Tombstone Tactical, and I was getting ready to pull the trigger on it, and I said, you know what, wait a minute, let me continue to search. And once you know, I found a place that had it for $22. So I was just gonna buy 2 from Tombstone Tactical, but I was like, okay, well, this is cheap enough where I can probably get 3. I got 3 and still undercut what it would have cost if I would have bought 2 from Tombstone Tactical. So I did good. So I got magazines coming in. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. Oh yeah. I ordered replacement levers, the stealth levers for the slide catch and the safety / decocker. And I don't know exactly when those are coming in. They have shipped. They did not send me tracking information. Probably because it's coming from it's an international resource. The store that I bought it from is located in Italy. So they have Beretta parts. I did searching because I put myself on the waiting list for these parts, because Beretta always runs out of them, and they are pretty much the only resource for these parts. I've heard a lot of complaints of people waiting for months, and I've been on the waiting list for the Beretta for the stealth levers for about a month, and I haven't heard anything yet. So what I did was I went to cowguns.net, and I was looking for people's feedback and experience with this gun to kind of, you know, make sure that I made a decent purchase, and if the gun was acting hokey for some people, I wanted to educate myself in case it happened to me as well. So when I was reading up on that, someone was talking about getting stealth levers, and they were voicing frustration because Beretta would always run out of stock. And someone said, well, I found a place in Italy that has them, and several people use them. There's been no complaints. They got the parts and everything in a timely fashion. I should have asked how long it took for them to get theirs, but we'll wait, because good things come to those who wait, right? So I cannot wait for those to come in, because this thing is wide as hell with those levers. And the last time I put the gun in the holster, and it was in my hand, you know, the holster was in my hand when I did it, you could see that it was pushing the backing material, because it stands out a good bit. It's like that in the holster as well. It's pushing the material away. So the sooner I get that, the better off I'll be. I don't notice it pushing like that when I have it holstered and on my hip. So the holster is doing good in that regard. It just kind of bugs me that, you know, I'm not OCD or anything, but it just looks weird. So when I get those parts, when I swap them out, I will be changing this into a G type. I will be taking out the ball bearing and the spring, so that, I mean, because I really don't use the safety. When I carry this, you know, I've carried it what, all of the last 24 hours. I mean, I use it to decock, like when I go to the range, and I'll do that before, probably after, you know, after we're done here, I'll load the gun back up and I'll use the decocker to kind of go back into DA mode. But I don't use the safety. I don't use the safety on any of my DASA guns. I don't need it. That's what DA mode is for. So I'm trying to think if there's anything else. No, there is not. I will take it to the range again tomorrow and shoot the rest of this, and maybe even go to Cabela's and pick up some more of this. It likes this. Most of my guns do. It's just that the Grand Power doesn't. What I really would like to do is find some of the Inceptor poly case for 9mm. I might have to order that, because as many times as I've been in Cabela's, they have them for the 380. I've seen them for 45 ACP. And I thought I saw some for 40 cal. But for some reason, either they're not stocking it or everyone's buying it. I would like to have more of it, so I might order some of that, just to kind of see how well it, you know, this shoots it. But the Bursa likes it. I've got 384. I bought some in 380 for the Bursa, and it fires it fine. I'm trying to think if there's anything else, because we're reaching the 30-minute mark here. One, two, three, we're done.